worship him, and doing so in spirit and in truth. We also greet all our guests and all those who are joining us online. As we worship our God today, may we do so with Paul's exhortation in Hebrews 12, 28, where he says, "Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom which cannot be shaken, let us have grace by which we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear." Let us sing from Psalter number 65, 3 and 4, 65, 3 and 4.
Congregation, the Lord has called us together to worship him, and we confess that our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth, and in Christ Jesus is an overflowing fountain of good. Amen. Receive the greeting of the Lord, grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father, through our Lord Jesus Christ, in the communion of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us praise God together with singing from Psalter number 263. 263, we'll sing all three stanzas. God reveals his righteousness to us by way of his law, and we are again given the opportunity to hear that law, reading it this morning from Deuteronomy 5 and the summary from Matthew chapter 22. Afterwards, let us sing from Psalter 112, stanza 2 and 4. 2 and 4, withhold not thou thy grace from me, O Lord, thy mercy let me see. 2 and 4. This is what the Lord God has said. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself a carved image, any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them nor serve them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children, to the third and fourth generations of those who hate me, but showing mercy to thousands, to those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless who takes his name in vain. Observe the Sabbath day to keep it holy, as the Lord your God commanded you. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. In it you shall do no work, you, nor your son, nor your daughter, nor your male servant, nor your female servant, nor your ox, nor your donkey, nor any of your cattle, nor your stranger who is within your gates, that your male servant and your female servant may rest as well as you. And remember that you were a slave in the land of Egypt, and the Lord your God brought you out from there by a mighty hand and by an outstretched arm. Therefore the Lord your God commanded you to keep the Sabbath day. Honor your father and your mother, as the Lord your God has commanded you, that your days may be long and that it may be well with you in the land which the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife. You shall not desire your neighbor's house, his field, his male servant, his female servant, his ox, his donkey, or anything that is your neighbor's. Teacher, which is the great commandment in the law? Jesus said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Let us read further in God's Word now from the Gospel of Mark. I invite you to turn in the Gospel of Mark to chapter 15. Our Pew Bible is page 901. And we'll read this morning from verse 16 through 28. Mark 15, verse 16 through 28. We've looked at the opening verses of this chapter 2 weeks ago when Jesus was accused, and then last Sunday morning when he was condemned. Now we read about him being led to the cross, Jesus crucified. So Mark 15, verse 16, the word of the Lord. Then the soldiers led him away into the hall called Praetorium, and they called together the whole garrison. And they clothed him with purple, and they twisted a crown of thorns, put it on his head, and began to salute him, "Hail, King of the Jews!" Then they struck him on the head with a reed, and spat on him, and bowing the knee, they worshipped him. And when they had mocked him, they took the purple off him, put his own clothes on him, and led him out to crucify him. Then they compelled a certain man, Simon, a Cyrenian, the father of Alexander and Rufus, as he was coming out of the country and passing by, to bear his cross. And they brought him to the place Golgotha, which is translated place of a skull. Then they gave him wine mingled with myrrh to drink, but he did not take it. And when they crucified him, they divided his garments, casting lots for them to determine what every man should take. Now it was the third hour, and they crucified him. And the inscription of his accusation was written above, "The King of the Jews." With him they also crucified two robbers, one on his right and the other on his left. So the scripture was fulfilled which says, "And he was numbered with the transgressors." So far the reading of God's word. These verses will be our text for this morning. Let us come to God in prayer and seek for his blessing as we worship him today. Holy and great God, our Father in heaven through Jesus Christ, we come before you in the morning of this day and give praise and thanks to you. You have seen fit to bring us here, to enable us to rise up from our beds and to prepare ourselves and to come into the house of God. And we thank you, Lord, for this special day. And we pray that you may be honored and glorified on this day of rest, this day of worship, this day of joy and gladness, this day that we pray may be for us even a little foretaste of the heavenly rest. We come, Lord, this morning as those who are poor and needy, as we sang just a few moments ago. It is true, we are poor and needy, left to ourselves. Physically, we can feel that, how frail we can be, how easily weary and tired we can be. And in other ways too, we experience our weakness, our need. But Lord, most of all, it's true of our souls. It's true of us spiritually. We are born in sin and we are far from you. We are separated from you and we need your grace to bring us back. And we need your grace also to keep us close. And we pray therefore for your grace and your mercy. As you have made these beautiful virtues and perfections known in your beloved Son. For in him the kindness and love of our God has appeared, not on account of works that we have done, but on account of him whom you have sent into this world and who has given himself. Even as we could read just a few moments ago on the cross, he hung as Savior and Lord of his people. And Lord God, we confess, therefore, to you our sins and how many they are and how great they are, how we sin in all kinds of ways. And yes, after another week of life, even after last Sunday being permitted to receive the Lord's Supper, still afterwards we sin, and so we need forgiveness. And we pray, Lord, that this morning you will again forgive us. Forgive us all our transgressions and iniquities and sin. And create in us clean hearts that love you and serve you. Help us also to hear the wide open invitation of your word, to seek the Lord while he is found, while he is near, and to call upon him while he is near. And let the wicked forsake his way and the unrighteous man his thoughts, and let him return to the Lord. Lord, help us to hear that and to understand that in a way that we obey that, to return to you and to find that you abundantly pardon. You are full of loving kindness. You are full of mercy and grace. Maybe we can struggle to understand that, but our thoughts are not your thoughts. Your ways are not our ways. As high as the heavens are above the earth, so high are your ways and your thoughts above ours. You are overflowing with readiness to forgive. And so, Lord, we pray that in our poor and needy state, we may run to you and we may find in you all we need for body and soul, for time and for eternity, for now and forever. We thank you that you have brought us together as a congregation. We pray for each one of the members, all who are in the pews this morning, and also those who are listening at home. For whatever reason, they are not able to be with us in person. We pray for one another, Lord, that you may uphold us and bless us. We thank you for mercies received. We thank you that you have brought Gary and Marietta safely home this week from Africa. For traveling mercies, Lord, and we pray for blessing on all they experienced and all they were able to do. We also thank you for the upcoming birthday of Sylvia Scholes, and we pray for her that you will bless her this coming week, together with her husband, and provide for her and for them in all their needs, and may they rejoice in your goodness, and may they praise you for all your gifts. We also pray for those who are laid up in various ways, those who are beset by chronic illness and weakness, those who are homebound because of that. We pray especially for Mrs. Spoolstra, that you will continue to remember her in all of her pain and discomfort. Please, O Lord, supply for her in all her needs and grant that she may receive some relief also and some healing mercies, and that you will bless whatever the doctors and nurses are able to do to make her more comfortable. We commend her to you today and pray that she may receive a special blessing from you today. And we pray for others who are under doctor's care. Continue to remember Rob Sinke with cancer treatments coming, and we commend him to you. And we pray, Lord, for others as well, also in our extended families, and those who are awaiting test results, and those who are having to live with certain conditions of body or of mind. We pray, O Lord, that in all our afflictions, we may continue to cry out to you, and that you may remember us, and that you may enable us to live close to you, and that we may say it is good for us when we are afflicted, because we learn your statutes. That even when we may suffer physically, we pray that we may thrive spiritually. And even when the outward man is breaking down, we pray that the inward man may be continually and increasingly renewed day by day. Help us above all not to lose heart in this world. For we have an exceedingly great weight of glory to come for all who belong to you. Because for us to live is Christ and to die is gain. And so, Lord, in view of that, we pray that we may go forward with our heads uplifted and with our steps firm and steady, and that we may run with endurance the race that is set before us. To that end, will you bless the ministry of the word among us? We pray, Lord, that wherever your word is brought today, you may be glorified. Be with Pastor Vandermeiden serving the Dundas congregation today. Fill him with your spirit and strengthen him, and remember all your servants. And remember us now, and as we consider the old story, and as we see the Lord Jesus by way of your word on the cross, we pray that our hearts may be drawn to him, that we may trust in him, that we may admire him, that we may love him and serve him as our only Savior and Lord. Hear our prayer. In his name we come. Amen. Let us continue to worship the Lord with our gifts, with our tithes and our offerings. We have the opportunity today to support the work of Come Over and Help Ministry in Eastern Europe. May the Lord bless you and your gifts Afterwards, let us sing together from Psalter number 47, from Psalm 22, and we'll sing stanzas 7, 8, and 9, words that David wrote through the Holy Spirit to prophesy ultimately of the Christ who would come and the suffering that he would endure. So we'll sing 47, stanzas 7, 8, and 9. Well, beloved congregation of our Lord Jesus Christ, so far in our study through Mark 15, we've heard about Jesus accused, and we've learned also about Jesus condemned. Jesus accused and Jesus condemned, and this morning we go a bit further and we find Jesus crucified. So that's what we're told in the verses that we read together from Mark 15, verse 16 through 28. Mark is describing for us how Jesus is crucified. And so we come, by way of this text, we come to the very focal point of Jesus' work, why he came into this world, why he was born. He came to be crucified. He was born to die. And right in this text, in this moment, we are witnessing that. With these verses, and also the verses that come later, what we'll consider next week more, Lord willing, when Jesus actually dies. Altogether, these words set forth to us the great wonder of our salvation. This is about the incarnate Son of God going to the cross, dying on that cross, and in so doing, on that cross, and by way of that cross, and through that cross, he is serving a Savior. So how do you hear that this morning? How do you hear that? Are you intrigued by that? And do these verses in any way amaze you? And do we find ourselves moved and humbled and drawn to the Lord again as we read these well-known words so that we seek him, the Lord Jesus, to be our Savior indeed and anew? How very important that is. And we should check ourselves on this point very carefully. In my preparation for this sermon, I came across the words of a faithful pastor down in Florida. Listen to what he wrote just a few years ago. "One of my greatest fears," he said, "one of my greatest fears for the church today is that we will become bored with the cross of Christ." Can you imagine? Bored with the cross? How is that possible? But apparently it is, or at least this pastor fears so. Going on with this quote, he says, "I am concerned that any mention of Christ and him crucified is leading many Christians, professing Christians, to say to themselves, 'Oh, I know all about Jesus dying on the cross for my sins. Let's move on to something else. Let's get past the basics.'" Now, maybe we don't have that problem here. I don't know. But isn't it a good reminder never to forsake the basics? We should never seek to get past this most basic of basics, that Jesus Christ was crucified for us. How we should love that. And at the same time, realize that we need to keep reviewing and reflecting on it because it is so easily forgotten. It so easily fades into the background. Whereas this is to be the very core, the very fundamental of who we are as Christians. We believe in a Savior who was crucified for us. Yes, and also rose again, but first the cross before the empty tomb. So may the Lord bless these moments together and our meditation together by way of these verses from Mark 15. Jesus crucified, that's our theme. Jesus crucified. And let's notice, first of all, the sufferings he had to endure. The sufferings. And obviously the sufferings began already before our text. They began, we might say, in the Garden of Gethsemane. And we can even say with our catechism in Lord's Day 15 that Jesus' sufferings started when he was conceived and born. In other words, they were lifelong sufferings, and that's true. But now at the end of his life, his sufferings begin to multiply and to intensify. And ever since his arrest in the Garden of Gethsemane, that's so. And the closer he gets to the cross, the worse things become. And so we read in verse 16 about how the soldiers lead Jesus away. After Pilate condemned Jesus, or maybe somewhere during that process, there may have been some back and forth. The other Gospels kind of suggest that. And some lulls in the proceedings. But at some point, the soldiers take Jesus into a hall and begin cruelly to mistreat him. The hall is called Praetorium. This was the governor's headquarters, some hall in some place where Pilate was situated while he was in Jerusalem, and the soldiers who maybe accompanied Pilate to help keep the peace in that Passover time, they take Jesus into that hall. They call all their buddies, of whom there could have been hundreds. A garrison was about 600 men. And then the fun began for them, because they take full advantage of Jesus and they start to mock him, as verse 20 says. And throughout they abuse him. It starts with clothing him with purple, probably some old soldier's cloak or something like that. Don't think beautiful, clean, attractive, majestic purple. No, think more dirty, faded purple rag. They took his clothes off him and put on this purple thing, no doubt in view of his claim to be a king. Purple was a royal color, still is. And so they start with that, and then they crown him, because kings ought to have a crown, but they don't give him a crown of gold, they give him a crown of thorns. All kinds of thorny plants grow in Palestine, and so they find one of these plants, and they cut some branches, and they weave them together, and no one's quite sure exactly what plant it was, but the thorns were no doubt long and sharp, and they drew blood when that crown was placed upon his head and pressed down upon his head. Someone has pointed out something I didn't know or maybe didn't remember. Think of the thorns that came into this world on account of sin. Remember what the Lord said to Adam about the ground that was cursed because of Adam's sin, how thorns and thistles it shall bring forth. And they pointed to the curse, and they reminded of the curse, and now they're set on the head of Christ. A thorny crown to remind us that he is bearing our curse. More on that later, but here, of course, the soldiers were simply thinking of Jesus claiming to be a king, and so let him have a crown. And what's wrong with a crown of thorns? It's just the thing, isn't it, for a pretend king. And then at that point, the soldiers in turn begin saluting Jesus, saying to him, "Hail, King of the Jews." It means something like, "We greet you, O King. We acknowledge you. We respect you." Of course, they don't, not really. But they pretend to. And then we read that they strike him on the head. Imagine that. They strike him on the head with a reed, with a stick. Matthew in his gospel says they first put the stick in his hand, as if it's a royal scepter. So they dress him up as a king of sorts, and they pretend to give him reverence and worship. "Hail, King of the Jews." And then they take that stick out of his hand and whammo! They strike him on the head, one after another, with the reed. John, in his account, he adds that they struck Jesus with their hands. So with the reed and with their hands, they hit him, they slap him, they pound him. How did he endure that? Blow after blow after blow. How could he survive that? And then, as a sign of ultimate contempt, they spat on him. One by one after another, the soldiers expressed their disgust for the Lord Jesus. And they do it by spitting on him. How awful he must have looked. Bloodied and bruised. His head, his face, his eyes, his cheeks. Don't forget his back as a result of the scourging. He must have looked hideous, not to mention the filthy spit of men running down his face and down his purple cloak. And so they had their fun with Jesus. How could it be that they do this to anyone? It's another revelation of the twisted and corrupt heart of man, isn't it? That man would do this to his fellow man. What makes it all the worse is that these were soldiers. These were men we might trust to serve and protect fellow human beings. They were supposed to be men of discipline and self-control, but at this moment, clearly not. And we learn here the real heart of man. We learn how sinful and depraved we can be, and we are by nature. And obviously what makes their behavior worst of all is that it's done to Christ, the King of the Jews, yes, and the King of all kings. The Bible says that someday every knee will bow, every single knee will bow before him. And when that day comes, there will be no mocking him, and there will be no hitting him and no spitting on him, because he will appear then in his sovereign majesty and glory, and every knee will be compelled to bow, and every tongue will be constrained to confess that Jesus is Lord. All these soldiers ought to have done that already now. They should have bowed already now. They should have said, he is Lord. But they didn't. And they wouldn't. And it highlights the darkness of our human heart. And meanwhile, through all of this, Jesus suffered. This point is about the sufferings he endured in his being crucified. And all of this happened on the way to the cross. How hard that must have been for him. And then when it is time for him to go to the cross to be crucified, he didn't get a ride. He had to walk. What's more, it was common for them to carry their own cross. Whether that be the whole cross or simply the cross beam, the commentaries debate, and some say just the beam, others say the whole thing. Even if it was just the beam, it was at least 75 to 100 plus pounds. It's one thing to carry that much weight in an exercise room. It's another thing to carry that much weight when you've been bloodied and bruised for hours and you have to walk with that weight on your back to the place of your execution. And we know from the other Gospels that Jesus simply couldn't do it. John in his Gospel, that Jesus went bearing his cross. So that's how it must have started. But very soon it was clear he couldn't keep up. And by the way, we find here in that another evidence of his humanity. Jesus was not suprahuman. He was not superhuman. He was human like we are, weak like we are. And all night he had been up, and all night he had suffered. How strong are you after a night of no sleep? And what if you had to go through all that he went through, the contempt, abuse, and everything else that he had to endure? And likely never given food or drink or opportunity to rest. Of course he couldn't bear his own cross. Who could? He was a man. So because he couldn't do it, the soldiers conscript a passerby. We'll come back to him later, Simon of Cyrene. He is forced to carry the cross. And so eventually the whole crew arrives at a place outside the city, a place with the name Golgotha, which means skull. Now, we don't know where this was exactly. There are some theories. One place is now housed by a church. Another place is a little bit further away. We just don't know. Nor do we know why it was called Golgotha. Maybe because it was a place of death. Maybe because it somehow reminded people of a skull. In any case, it was a foreboding name for an awful place. And there we read about Jesus being crucified. So they didn't stone him. They didn't behead him. They didn't hang him. They didn't inject him with a chemical that in a matter of moments took his life. No, they crucified. Verse 24 says they crucified him. It was a common way of executing terrible criminals in the time of the Roman Empire. It means they laid him down on the cross somehow and pounded spikes into his hands, into his feet. And then they lifted up the cross so that it stood upright on the ground, in the ground, and so he hung between heaven and earth. And there he hung and hung and hung. And we can't imagine the pain of that. How intense it must have been, the initial moments and then the long moments and hours that followed. Death by crucifixion was sheer torture, seemingly unendingly dying. His body must have been in shock. His whole frame must have been racked with pain. Every breath must have been agonizing. And then there was the shame of it. Whether he had any clothes on still is debated. Certainly, his outer clothes were all taken away and gambled for by the soldiers who were attending his death. Needless to say, he was very vulnerable and he was subject to scorn. And then there was the humiliation of being crucified between two robbers, as Mark calls them. And they were that, no doubt, robbers. But don't think petty thief kind of robber, stealing a chocolate bar kind of robber. Don't even think like a bank robber. These were probably rebels of the kind like Barabbas. Some have conjectured even that Jesus was hanging on the cross that was meant for Barabbas. In other words, these men were revolutionaries. These men on either side of Jesus, they weren't afraid of anyone, and they weren't afraid to do anything. Lie, steal, kill, whatever it took to get their way. Especially to get rid of Rome. Zealots these men may have been, kind of sect in those days. And if possible, they were very evil men with hardly a conscience left. Some of the worst of the worst. And Jesus hangs in the midst of them as if he is one of them. How shameful. The text says, numbered with the transgressors. And this too is part of his suffering. His suffering. What sufferings he endured. And congregation, it is good to work through this mentally, personally, spiritually. Not to sensationalize it or to sentimentalize it. No, we don't want to pity Jesus. And we don't want just to focus on all the physicality of his sufferings. But let's at least remember what he had to undergo. We can say it so unthinkingly sometimes. He suffered and died. And that's true. And those summary words matter. But behind them is a whole history of misery, pain, shame, agony, and more. And so Jesus crucified. What sufferings he had to endure. But now something else, our second main point. The submission he displayed. The submission Jesus displayed. Submission means he didn't argue. He didn't talk back. He didn't quit. Submission means he served. He was steadfast. He stayed at it. He was obedient to his Father's will. Submissive he was. And in two particular ways we see this in these verses. Two ways we see Jesus' submission. One is in his passivity. And what I mean by that is time after time, things are done to him and they happen to him and with him. Notice that. Notice how even the text highlights that. If we pay attention to the verbs, starting in verse 16, they led him. Verse 17, they clothed him. They put a crown of thorns on his head. Verse 18, they salute him. 19, they struck him, spat on him, and worshipped him. 20, they mocked him, put his own clothes on him, and led him out to crucify him. 22, they brought him to the place Golgotha. 23, they gave him wine. More on that in a moment. 24, they crucified him. 25, they crucified him. 27, with him they crucified two robbers. 28, he was numbered with the transgressors. And the point is, all these things were done to him. And while they're being done, he's passive. He takes it. He lets it happen. He submits to it. He's submissive. Isn't that something? I mean, that's amazing. Never once does he object or push back, with the exception of the wine. Again, more on that in a moment. But for the rest, he lets it all happen. All the mockery, all the abuse, all the violence, every blow. He's led to the hall. He's brought to the cross. They nail him to the cross. They hang him up. And all the while, he's passive. He lets them do it. Why didn't he ever say, now that's enough? Why didn't he break loose like Samson did long ago when he was tied up? And, you know, Samson broke loose and chased his enemies away and even killed many of them. Why didn't Jesus do that here? Why did he let them mistreat him hour after hour after hour? Why didn't he transform himself in these moments and reveal his glory? Why didn't he show his power and his majesty? Why didn't he stand up for himself and defeat all his enemies? Instead, he took it. He just took everything that was given to him. As we watch him, we have to say he's incredible, isn't he? I mean, just think what you're like, what I'm like when we get pushed around a little. Maybe someone accidentally knocks you as they walk by. Or maybe someone ignores you. Or maybe they take your piece of cake. Or maybe they step in front of you into the bathroom in the morning. Excuse me, you say. And if they did it on purpose, we're even less happy. Come on. as us, with barely the slightest of offenses. It doesn't take much for us to get very growly and worse. Meanwhile, here is Jesus going through infinitely worse, and he takes it all, and he doesn't respond. And what is going on? The answer is, he is submitting to his Father. He is submitting to the call of God upon his life. He is submitting to that holy and mysterious transaction that is taking place, whereby God is laying on his Son the iniquity of us all and compelling him to suffer for it in our place. And Jesus knows that that is what God has called him to do, and he bows to it entirely. And notice too how he confirms that when he does something, when he finally does do something. And now think of the wine mingled with myrrh that's given him to drink. Apparently this was a mixture given to victims of crucifixion to help dull some of the pain. Maybe it knocked them out a little. Maybe it made them just a little bit woozy in their head, so that they didn't feel so intensely all the pain they were suffering. It was particularly a Jewish act of mercy, or it may have been rooted in that at least. Somewhere I read about Jewish women doing this for the crucified, and doing it in faithfulness to words like we find in Proverbs 31, verse 6 and 7. Give strong drink to him who is perishing, and wine to those who are bitter of heart. Let him drink and forget his poverty, and remember his misery no more. And so maybe in obedience to that word, wine mingled with myrrh was offered to Jesus. Here, Jesus, this will help. And now for the first time in our text, for the first time, Jesus is obviously active. I mean, throughout the verses when he's passive, he's also active. His submission is active, but the expression of it is so passive. Everything happens to him. But now suddenly he does something. Here, Jesus, this will help. Drink this. But he says no. Verse 23, he did not take it. So that's his only activity in these verses. And what an activity. Refusing to drink the mixture that might help to relieve his suffering, that might allow him to check out for a while, not be as aware or conscious, maybe just give a little relief from the agony consuming him. But he did not take it. He did not take it. Do you understand that? What happens when we have a headache or something else? We go find some medicine, Tylenol, Advil, whatever, something to take the pain away, something to relieve the suffering, of course. Ordinarily, we should do that. It's a gift of God to take the medicine. But here in this moment, Jesus says, no, he did not take it. Why not? Isn't the answer this? He must have wanted to be as alert and engaged and conscious and involved in his sufferings as possible. He must have said to himself, as hard as this is, as impossible as it is to bear, I need to be as alert as I can. He must have believed that he could not miss any moment in that crucial time. All the pain had to be fully felt. Every second had to be experienced. It was not acceptable to be able to sleep through any of these profound moments. No sleeping, not even dulling the pain. Why? Because he was submitting to his Father. He wanted to obey his Father's will. He wanted to leave nothing undone of all that his Father had called him to do. And what was it now that his Father had called him to do? What was all this suffering for? And why was he submissive to it in this way? Well, asking that question takes us then to our last point. And it's this, the salvation he was achieving. The salvation. Because that's what this is about, as we know. This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. And the only way to save sinners like you and me, the only way is to suffer all of this in our place. The truth is that we deserve to suffer like he did. and forever. The truth is that we deserve to be cursed and crucified. And the reason for that is, as we know, our sin in Adam. In other words, the fact that we are guilty and defiled by virtue of our connection to Adam. We are guilty, we are defiled, and so we are in trouble, and we add to that trouble with countless sins every single day. Sadly, by nature, and that's part of the blinding power of sin, we don't see how bad it is so often. We don't see how dangerous it is. But the Bible tells us, the Word of God makes it clear, and the Spirit of God seeks to drive it home to our heart. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God, and the wages of sin is death. And death means eternal death. But Jesus came into the world to save sinners. And he's doing that here in the text. This text, all about suffering and submission, is ultimately about saving, Jesus saving his people from their sins. And our text gives two pictures of that. And let's look at that as we close. The first one involves Simon, a Cyrenian. Now he's the man in verse 21 of whom we read that the Romans compelled him to bear Jesus' cross. In other words, to carry it to the hill of crucifixion. Well, that's clear enough. But why is he named the way he is? Simon, a Cyrenian, and especially the father of Alexander and Rufus. Why those details? What seems clear is that Mark's readers in Rome, by the way, let's remember that, Mark likely wrote to the Roman Christians, and so it seems they must have known Alexander and Rufus. By way of Mark mentioning them here the way he does, it's as if he's assuming his people who will be reading him will say, oh, we know Alexander, we know Rufus. The father of Alexander and Rufus carried the cross. All right, people would say, we know who's in view. What's also interesting is that Paul, in his letter to the Romans, refers at one point to a man named Rufus. You may know that. Romans 16, verse 13, when he's greeting all kinds of people, greet also Rufus and his mother, dear people to Paul. Could be the same Rufus. But in any case, it seems reasonable to believe that Simon's experience bearing Jesus' cross was somehow transformative, that God used it to change Simon and to save him. And if we just think that through for a moment, here he is, a traveler, one day from the country into the city. He's got his plans, he's got his agenda, he's got his timeline, but on the way he's suddenly accosted by Roman soldiers, and they at sword point compel him to drop all his plans for the moment and to carry a condemned prisoner's cross. Well, that was unfortunate, he may have thought. Why do I have to do this? And maybe he wondered as he toiled his way to Golgotha, maybe he wondered, who is this man for whom I'm carrying the cross, and why is he dying? What has he done? And maybe Simon stayed for a while afterwards and heard Jesus' words on the cross. Maybe he saw the sign on the cross. Maybe he witnessed Jesus die. We don't know all those details, but the way the text reads, it seems something happened and that his life was changed and that his family was impacted and the whole experience God used in a way to save him and his wife and his sons. Somehow through the Holy Spirit's work, Simon must have come to see he deserved not simply to carry that cross, he deserved to die on that cross. And that's true. And he deserved it, and you deserve it, and I deserve it too. And yet when he came to Golgotha, Simon was free, whereas Jesus was crucified. And if somehow that impacted Simon and led him to his conversion, again, we maybe can't be sure, but it seems likely, and it would be just like Jesus, wouldn't it, in the midst of dying, to be saving. And let's realize the point again, that's our cross on which he hung, and yet it becomes his, so that he might save us and deliver us from ever having to hang on that cross. And is that not confirmed in the second picture in our text? Well, we're told in verse 28. Now, verse 28 is a problem in some translations, and I mention this because some of you bring different translations to worship, and if, for example, you have an ESV, you will notice that 28 is not in the text. That's because it's not in different Greek manuscripts. They result in our translations. All our translations come from copies of the Bible in Greek, manuscripts as we call them, and there are many, many copies of manuscripts. And so those translations that follow the earliest manuscripts, for example, they don't include verse 28 because verse 28 is not in the earliest manuscripts. Well, someone might say, is that a problem? Maybe, maybe not. Verse 28 is in many other hundreds of later manuscripts. And what is more, what does verse 28 say? Well, 28 says, the scripture was fulfilled, which says he was numbered with the transgressors. What scripture? It's from Isaiah 53. It's from Isaiah 53, verse 12. And so, what do we do with this? Well, we say, even if this verse wasn't in the first copies of Mark, or let me say it like this, even if Mark himself didn't write this, then someone else did later, and God, by his providence, made sure that it ends up in many manuscripts as a quotation of the Old Testament to help make clear the point of Jesus' suffering. And that's the important thing now. Let's understand verse 28 and Isaiah 53 both make clear Jesus is not suffering for himself, but he is suffering as a substitute. He was never a transgressor, but he was numbered with the transgressors. He was counted among the transgressors. He hung there as if he was a transgressor, one who had broken the law, one who had crossed the line, one who had deserved now the judgment of God, never mind the judgment of Rome. And this is the picture that we need to grasp. It's incredibly significant because you are a transgressor. And so am I. We have crossed the line countless times. Likely you have done it this very week. Maybe you have done it this very morning. You have disobeyed God. You have sinned against him. And left to ourselves, that reality means the end of us forever. But he was numbered with the transgressors, because he was paying for the transgressors, because he was paying for transgression, because he was suffering to appease the wrath of God, because he was at work to cancel the debt of sin that we owe, because he was achieving our salvation, so that every transgression on our conscience may be covered by his saving work. That's the most important need we have, isn't it? And that's the greatest thing he has ever done. And that's why we should never get past the cross. And why? How could we ever be bored with the cross? Because Jesus on the cross, Jesus crucified, is how we may be delivered from all our sins and miseries. How we may lose the burden of guilt that goes with us everywhere in life. We may lose it as we come to Christ, and because of his cross work, we may be delivered, we may be set free from the debt we owe, we may be reconciled to God and live at peace with God, we may be happy in life, and we may die in peace. And our lives may be changed, and our homes and our families and everything, everything about our life may undergo a transformation, because though we are transgressors, he was numbered among the transgressors so that we might be forgiven our transgressions. Do you see then what reason we have to love these verses and to cherish all they proclaim? And not simply to love the verses and their message, but especially to love the one they describe and all that he endured and displayed and achieved. Because we need to be saved. And by him only we may be saved, and we must be saved. And when you look to him, you will be saved, and you are saved. Because he was crucified. He was crucified. And so let us hear this, congregation, and believe in him. He calls us to that faith again today. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you shall be saved. Amen. Let us pray. O Lord Jesus Christ, we humble ourselves before you this morning as we have considered your word and how you suffered, what sufferings you endured, and the way you submitted. So, almost unbelievably, we could never have done so, but you did. Even refusing that wine mingled with myrrh so that you could be alert to everything you had to undergo, so that you could fully pay for all the transgressions and sins of all your people. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for your saving work, and even in the way that you suffered and died involving Simon. And we have good reason to believe saving Simon in the process and being numbered with the transgressors. And elsewhere we learn even saving one of those transgressors. Today you will be with me in paradise, you said. And so also for all who turn to you and trust in you, with all of their shame and guilt and all of their transgressions, all of their past, and we all have a past, and we all sin still in the present. But how blessed is he whose sin is covered, whose transgression is covered. And it may be so because you were crucified. So, Lord, we pray that we may never be bored with the cross and never think we need to get past the cross. But may we ever boast in the cross. May we cherish the cross. May we find our salvation in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. Please bless the word through the power of your Holy Spirit. Grant there be none here who remain unsaved. Grant that we all may be saved and sanctified and increasingly strengthened in our commitment to you, to serve you, to follow you all the days of our life. We pray that you will hear us and help us now as we go from here. Bless our fellowship. Bless the Sunday school classes that meet and the teachers and the children as they learn. And Lord, that your word not return to you void. Glorify your name among us, we pray. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Let us close with singing from Psalter number 277. 277 stands at 1, 3, and 8. And our doxology, 304, 1, 3, and 7. Receive now the blessing of the Lord, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.